Χαίρετε, χαίρετε.
Καλησπέρα σε όλους.
Καλησπέρα σε όλους.
Μην είναι
μια
εκπομπή.
Είμαι ο Γιώργος Καρούλιας.
Είμαι ο Γιώργος Καρούλιας.
Μαζί μου είναι ο Αντρέας Τσακαλίδης.
Καλησπέρα,
Αντρέα.
Καλησπέρα,
Γιώργο.
Πίσω από τις κάμερες.
Πίσω από τις κάμερες.
Είναι όλα στα κρύβια ακόμα.
Και μαζί μας έχουμε την τιμή να έχουμε έναν από τους αγαπημένους μας. Ένας από τους αγαπημένους μας. Ένας από την Ελλάδα. Ποτέ από την Ελλάδα.
Thank you guys.
Coronavirus,
but now we have spiked back up.
Now we have spiked back up in certain states.
And for me,
everything that Dr. Fauci said
by wearing the mask,
social distancing,
I think it's okay.
I think it's okay.
I started back. I started at the YMCA.
At the YMCA, I am the director of sports.
I am the director of sports.
And
we're now
as long as they have their mask.
How did the virus epidemic affect sports there? Well, we saw the NBA bubble, but in general, we would like to learn about the sports in general.
Well, what it did was it shut everything down. My son didn't find out until maybe 3 weeks ago that his basketball season would go on. Here in Ohio, the governor is really awesome. He, as soon as the virus hit, he stopped school. There were no more schools. I think that saved a lot of kids here in Ohio. Now, I think what's going on is they're making mistakes as far as not doing social distancing and masks. If we do this, we should be fine.
We would like to learn more about your past. You know, okay. our show is a retro one. Mm-hmm. And we would like to learn more about your past and remember things. So let's start. You're a Florida native. You were born in Riviera Beach. What made you want to play basketball? What made you think I will be a basketball player?
My brother, Cecil Relford, was one of the best players in my neighborhood, who ended up going to college at St. John's University in New York. But for me, unlike a lot of kids who their heroes were Dr. J and Magic and all these guys, well, my brother was my hero. And he's the one that made me who I am as far as a basketball player, because I went to New York and I hung out with him quite a bit, and he showed me the things that I needed to know to become the basketball player that I was.
I will translate that a bit. Λέει ότι ο Ριτς λέει ότι παρά το γεγονός ότι περισσότεροι της εποχής του είχαν είδωλα είτε τον Dr. J είτε τον Magic Johnson, εκείνος είχε είδωλο τον αδερφό του, ο οποίος έπαιξε και στο κολέγιο του St. John's. Αντρίκο, παρεπιπτόντως, αν κάνω κάποιο λάθος ή ξεχνάω κάτι να μεταφράσω, μου λες, έτσι. You played in Sunshore University, am I correct?
My brother played at St. John's.
No, about you, you played, where did you play? High school in Florida, I guess?
Yes, high school, I played at Suncoast High School.
Suncoast. By the way, it was next to the beach, and the sea would play a great part in your career, because every team you would play was next to the sea.
Yes, I'm a Floridian, and when you're a Floridian, you love the sun, you love the beaches, and I tried to make sure, but I was lucky, I think I was blessed by God to be able to play in all these beautiful places.
Do you like surf?
Oh, that's true.
Do I like what?
Surf.
No, I don't surf, period. Never got on a surfboard. I like going to the beach and getting into the water up to my waist. Further than that, no, because we have sharks in Florida.
τον ρώτησα, του είπα ότι μεγάλωσε στη Φλόριντα. ο Ανδρέας είπε ότι αν κάνει σέρφινγκ, είπε όχι, γιατί εμείς έχουμε και καρχαρίες στη Φλόριντα. Γενικότερα ένιωσε ευλογημένος που έπαιξε σε όλες αυτές τις χώρες οι οποίες περιβάλλονταν από νερό. In high school you became an All-American 1982 and you met with a legend of the sport. One guy that in the United States, he's a legend. Nothing short of it. John Wooden. How did you feel back then when you met him? Did you feel any awe? Did he advise you anything?
This is what we did. This is what happened. The top 25 players in the McDonald's All-American team, we all get to meet John Wooden. And the reason we got to meet John Wooden, because he's the greatest college coach ever in the history of college sports in America. And so what they did was we would sit and we would talk to him. And he would just tell us things like, you know, continue to play hard. Congratulations on becoming McDonald's All-Americans. And on my McDonald's All-American team, I had Johnny Dawkins. I had Benoit Benjamin. I had Kerry Trotter. We had great teams. Off of that McDonald's All-American team, I think over half of us played in the NBA.
Did he advise you anything? Did he tell you anything specific that you kept in your later life?
Always play hard. That was the one thing I took from him. He said, always give 150%. And if you do that, you'll achieve every goal that you want. And I remember that.
Ο Wooden είναι ένας τρύλος στο παγκόσμιο μπάσκετ και το ρώτησα όταν έγινε All-American στο High School 1982. Η βασική συμβουλή που έδωσε στους παίκτες εκεί, παράλληλα όπως ο Μπένουαν Μπέντζαμιν και κάποιοι άλλοι παίκτες, είπε πάντα να παίζεις σκληρά, να δίνεις το 150% του ταλέντου σου, του εαυτού σου. Αντρίκο μου, θα συνεχίσεις?
Ναι. Richard, after your graduation from high school, you were recruited from Michigan Wolverines in 82. Mm-hmm. Great team, great teammates, great players. And in 84, you won the National Invitation Tournament, the first ever championship in the history of the college. And you have teammate, a person here in Greece we love, but unfortunately he's... He's late. The late Roy Tarpley. Mm-hmm. Will you talk about Roy? Will you say something about Roy?
I will always say something about Roy Tarpley. Me and Roy Tarpley were college roommates for 3 years. We lived together. And I tried to explain to people. I know you guys know who Mark Aguirre is, who played with Roy in Dallas. Well, at Roy's funeral, it was a lot. It wasn't many people because it was private. Well, I was there. Mark Aguirre was there. And Mark Aguirre said something that I'll never forget. If Roy was still playing in the NBA, he could have become one of the greatest, 50 top greatest NBA players of all time. But we all have these things that we fight in our lives. And Roy just had things that he had to fight that he couldn't get through. But I just want people to know, Roy Tarpley was one of the best people I had ever met in my life. And it's a privilege for me to call him my brother and to live with him for as long as we did in college.
Ο Ρίτσαρντ μετά την αποφύτισή του από το Λύκειο πήγε κολέγιο στο Μίσιγκαν, στους Wolverines του Μίσιγκαν, όπου κέρδισε το National Invitation Tournament το 1984. Οκ, θα συνεχίσει ξανά.
Rich, by the way, συγγνώμη Αντρίκο μου, Rich, by the way, if you're listening to us, οκ.
Και ήταν συμπαίχτης με τον Roy Tarpley. Ρωτήσαμε τον Ρίτσαρντ για να μας μιλήσει για τον Roy και μας είπε ότι ήταν συγκάτοικος με τον Roy στο κολέγιο τα 4 χρόνια. Ήταν ένας πραγματικά εξαιρετικός παίχτης, απίστευτος παίχτης και συγκεκριμένα μας μίλησε για τον συμπαίχτη του στους Mavericks, τον Mark Aguirre, ένα τεράστιο όνομα στο NBA, ο οποίος παρευρέθηκε στην κηδεία του Roy μαζί με το Ρίτσαρντ το 2015. Και ο Ρίτσαρντ συγκράτησε αυτό που είπε τότε ο Μάρκ Αγκουάιρ, ότι αν ο Ρόι δεν είχε αυτά τα προβλήματα που είχε και δεν πάλευε με αυτούς τους προσωπικούς δαίμονες, θα ήταν μέσα στους 50 καλύτερους παίκτες όλων των εποχών στο NBA. Αυτό για το Ρόι Τάρπλεϊ, για να καταλάβουμε ποιος ήταν αυτός ο παίκτης που εκείνο το καλοκαίρι του 1992 ήρθε στην Ελλάδα και πάτησε το πόδι στη Θεσσαλονίκη. After you graduate, from college, you drafted from number 96, if I remember well.
Yes.
But you never tried, you didn't try to the NBA at this year, 86. You went to CBA. Mm-hmm. You were scoring champion in CBA.
Mm-hmm. Well, I went to the CBA because the Indiana Pacers sent me to the CBA.
Oh.
And what happened was when they sent me to the CBA and I played really well, well, that next summer, I didn't go back to them because I went to San Antonio because I was a free agent. They thought that they could sit me there and nobody would take me. And then they could get me back. Well, San Antonio stepped in and they had a coach at that time, Coach Ross and I can't remember my coach's name there.
Larry Brown.
No, Weiss. Bob Weiss.
Bob Weiss.
Yeah, Bob Weiss. And him and Lee Rose were the coaches there. And they called me back up. You remember in the CBA, I played for a guy by the name of Cassie Russell. Cassie Russell was one of the greatest Michigan, matter of fact, the greatest Michigan player of all times. And he also won a championship with the New York Knickerbockers when he was in the NBA. And so I think that was a lot.
Excuse me, a bit. Was that the guy in 1965 who went to the championship finals in the NCAA?
Yes, this is the same guy. Yo, I love you guys. You guys are on top of your stuff. Yes, this is the same guy, Cassie Russell.
Προτείνω να συνεχίσω. Βασικά θέλω να ρωτήσω εγώ κάτι. Θα ρωτήσω εγώ. At first, I would like to ask something about the Michigan. The Michigan Wolverines are one of the best college teams in the history of the NCAA. The first step towards that was in 1965, as we said, when the Wolverines got to the finals.
Mm-hmm.
But the first title, it was your team in 1984 and the National Invitation Tournament with players like Tim McCormick, the late Roy Tarpley. How important was that? Because in later years, your team became superpower in the college basketball. But back then, you weren't as successful. How important was that for the legacy of the college?
I think it was very important because what it did was it started us on a way of winning championships because, yes, the NIT was the first one, but right after the NIT, we won the Big Ten title back-to-back for the first time ever. And the Big Ten is our conference, so it was the conference championship. But what it did was we started getting great recruits because, as you guys said earlier, we had Glenn Rice, who played in the NBA for a long time. We had Mark Hughes, who played in the NBA for a long time. And Lloyd Vault, they also played in the NBA a long time. So we started something, and Juwan Howard and all these, Chris Webber and all these guys came in behind us. And if you talk to those guys to this day, they'll let you know by us playing the way we did back then, helped them to choose to come to Michigan.
Τον ρώτησα σχετικά με την κληρονομιά που έφερε ο τίτλος του στο NIT το 1984. Και ουσιαστικά τους έδωσε αυτή την νοοτροπία του νικητή. Και όχι μόνο έμαθε η ομάδα να κερδίζει, γιατί μετέπειτα κατέκτησαν και δύο Big Ten περιφέρειες. Είναι η περιφέρεια πριν το κύριο τουρνουά. Εκτός από αυτό, έφεραν και καλύτερους παίκτες. Ο Ρίτς πρόλαβε τον Glenn Rice την τελευταία του χρονιά. Μετά ήρθαν παίκτες όπως ο Lloyd Vaught, ο Chris Webber, ο Juwan Howard, ο οποίος είναι τώρα προπονητής στους Michigan Wolverines. Γενικότερα ήταν σημαντικός αυτός ο τίτλος γιατί έδειξε το δρόμο στις επόμενες γενιές. It paved the way for the next generations, that's what I said. Could you tell us a bit more about your NBA experience? No, it was a bit short, but I read that you blocked Karl Malone and I would like to learn more about that.
Well, it was my first NBA game. We were playing the Utah Jazz in Utah. And I was surprised because I go in the beginning of the second quarter and I'm thinking, nah, you know, that's early. But I go in and Karl Malone, they get a break. They go on a fast break. And I kind of come from behind. And when I blocked it, I think I surprised Karl Malone. But I also surprised myself because I didn't realize it was Karl Malone. For me, it's basketball. And I'm just going to defend our basket. And it was one of my greatest highlights. Me and my son laugh about it now to this day.
Did you get an elbow as a gift?
No, you know what's funny? No, I didn't. But he gave me the meanest look. I just started laughing. I just thought it was crazy.
Highlight της καριέρας του στο NBA ήταν όταν έτρεξε, όταν ο Karl Malone βγήκε στον ευνηδιασμό στο πρώτο του παιχνίδι, στον ντεμπούτο του. Εκείνος δεν κατάλαβε τον Karl Malone, γιατί λέει, για μένα είναι απλά μπάσκετ. Δεν με ενδιαφέρει αν είναι ο Malone ή οποιοδήποτε άλλος, δεν το κοίταξα καν. Και του ρίχνει τάπα και λέει ότι χιουμοριστικά ότι δεν έφαγε αγωνιά σαν δώρο. Απλά ο Malone ήταν, είχε μείνει έκπληκτος και τον κοίταξε με το πιο άγριο βλέμμα που υπάρχει. Αντρίκο μου, συνέχισε.
Richard, after the short NBA experience, you flew for Atlantic and you went to Israel, the NBA of Europe, we called it then. Maccabi Rishon, and you had teammate one of the greatest Israeli and European players of all time, great Mickey Berkovic. Will you tell us something about Mickey and Maccabi?
Yes, first of all, it's the only Maccabi Rishon is the only team in Europe, and even though it's the Middle East, that I played 2 years back-to-back. And Mickey was the reason. Because Mickey Berkovich, even though we get older, one thing that Mickey could do was really shoot that ball. He could shoot, and he was very quick. And Mickey made my experience there for my first time. He made it really enjoyable. Because we had a guy by the name of Heinz Lippmann as well. They were both really good shooters. But Mickey was one of the top professionals that I had ever played with in all of Europe.
Ακούσαμε τον Ρίτσαρντ μετά την μικρή εμπειρία του NBA. Πέρασε τον Ατλαντικό και πήγε στο Ισραήλ για την Maccabi Rishon, όπου εκεί είχε συμπαίχτη έναν από τους μεγαλύτερους Ευρωπαίους παίχτες των εποχών, τον Μίκι Μπέρκοβιτς. Ο Ρίτσαρντ είχε μια πολύ σπουδαία εμπειρία με τον Μίκι και τη Maccabi, που έμεινε 2 χρόνια, η μοναδική ευρωπαϊκή ομάδα που έμεινε 2 χρόνια. Γιατί ο Μίκη, εκτός από εξαιρετικός σουτέρ, παρότι ήταν μεγάλος ηλικία εκείνη την περίοδο, ήταν νομίζω 37-38 χρονών, ήταν ένας παίχτης που ήξερε να σκοράρει, βασικό, και επίσης ήταν τρομερός συμπαίχτης. Και έχει αφήσει πολύ καλές εμπειρίες στο Ρίτσαρντ αυτή η συνύπαρξη με τον Μίκη Μπέρκοβιτς. And after the country that you loved and we love you, Ike, and Krešimir Ćosić, the late Krešimir Ćosić.
Yes.
Your experience with Ike and Krešo.
Well, Ike was one of the first teams that, when I got there, I had never ever seen the fans react to players the way they do in Ike. When I tell you, people used to say to me, be careful because these are crazy fans. Well, let me explain. They were crazy, but they were our fans. I didn't really care about anybody else's fans because we had the crazy fans in Ike. And you'll be amazed. When I got there, Coach was, we knew he was famous. And me and John Flowers ended up playing with Ike as well. I just thought that it was one of the greatest places. They had one of the best gyms. We say in their gym, we said that their floor, anyone could dunk off of their floor because it had felt like it had springs underneath the floor. That's how good their floor was.
Γιώργο, συγγνώμη, το κατάλαβες το τελευταίο. Τι είπε για το παρκέ.
Νομίζω ότι κατάλαβα ότι... Could you tell us a bit more about the hardcore? I did not understand exactly what you said.
Yes, I understand him talking to you, so I kind of understood that a little bit. The parquet. what I meant was, you go to any gym, and you go to their parquet, and it's really, really hard. It's supposed to be. But it was something at Ike that it was like their floor was built on top of like a trampoline. You know what a trampoline is? That's what it
felt. Yeah.
And that's why everybody in their gym, we used to always say it had bounce. Like a it had bounce, meaning it was like you was jumping off a trampoline on their floor. And everybody dunked so nice in their gym. And that was the one thing I missed about Ike, was their gym. They had an amazing gym.
Did you have any dunk contest with Nasser Galateros?
Please, me and Nico, yeah, we had a few. I thought he was a great young player because he was young when I got there. And I thought he was going to be great. He ended up being a great player there. But, yeah, we had a few. I think I must have won them all, though.
Ο Ρίτσαρντ, λοιπόν, μετά την εμπειρία στο Ισραήλ, ήρθε στην Ελλάδα, η χώρα που αγάπησε και τον αγαπήσαμε, για την ΑΕΚ. Αυτό που θυμάται φυσικά είναι η τρελή οπαδή κάθε ελληνική ομάδα εκείνη την εποχή, όπως επίσης και τον προπονητή, τον μεγάλο Κρέσμι Τσόσιτς, και το γυμναστήριο της ΑΕΚ, το Γιώργος Μόσχος, το παλιό γήπεδο της ΑΕΚ, με το παρκέ που ήταν τόσο μαλακό, σαν να ήταν από κάτω, σαν να είχε τραμπολίνο, και το οποίο ευνοούσε τα καρφώματα. Και ο Ρίτσαρντ είχε κάποιους διαγωνισμούς καρφωμάτων με τον Άσο Γαλατερό, που τότε ήταν αρκετά νεαρός, αλλά όπως μας είπε, τους κέρδισε όλους. Γιώργο, αν θέλεις.
You stayed in Ike for about 8 games and then you went to another Mediterranean country, Spain, in Girona. There you had some great teammates like a current coach of the EuroLeague, Dusko Ivanovic. And how was things in Spain? It was a bit more calm. It was calmer there than in Greece, I guess.
Well, in Spain, the ACB was more athletic. It wasn't more physical because the Greek league was more. To me, the Greek league was more like the NBA. You know, you guys say Israel, but we felt like the Greek league was more like NBA games because not only was there physicalness, but it was also the athleticness, the athletes of that country. They were really athletic, and so that's what made it for us more like the NBA. We love that part about Greece, but I got to tell you, Spain was more finesse. That's the word I'm looking for. They were more finesse. Greece, no, it was physical. And me personally, I cared more for the Greek league than I did any other league.
Before I translate, I wanted to expand on this. As an NBA, as an American player, a player that has played in the NBA, has felt the physicality of the NBA, what type of basketball did you like? The fast tempo of Israel, the hard defense, slow tempo of Greece, or the finesse and a bit of run and gun of Spain?
I like the physicalness of Greece because the Greeks, you could hit us and we could hit them and they wouldn't call those cheap fouls. You know, in Spain, it was more finesse, but you could foul out quick. In Israel, it was more finesse as well. They let you play a little bit more in Israel. But for me, the Greek League and a lot of my friends, the Greek League was the best.
Ουσιαστικά το ρωτήσαμε για τις διαφορές του Ισπανικού και του πρωταθλήματος Ισραήλ με το Ελληνικό. Ο Ρίτς θεωρεί ότι το ελληνικό πρωτάθλημα θυμίζει περισσότερο το NBA γιατί ήταν πιο physical. Ουσιαστικά έπεφτε ξύλο, οι διαιτητές δεν θα σφύριζαν όλα αυτά τα φτηνά φάουλ, ενώ στην Ισπανία θα έβγαινες πολύ γρήγορα έξω με 5 φάουλ, συγγνώμη. Ουσιαστικά λέει ότι το πρωτάθλημα μας ήταν πιο σκληρό, πιο δυνατό, ίσως πιο αθλητικό, αντίθετα στην Ισπανία ήταν λίγο πιο τεχνικό. Σωστά το λέω, Ανδρέα?
Ναι, σωστά.
Ήταν λίγο πιο τεχνικό, στο Ισραήλ ήταν λίγο πιο γρήγορο. Σίγουρα αυτό που προτιμάει ο ίδιος είναι το δικό μας πρωτάθλημα, το οποίο και το αγάπησε και το έδειξε και συνέχεια. And then you went back to the CBA. How come you went back? Did you wanted to try again to go to the NBA?
Well, no, I go back to the CBA because me and my agent had talked about getting back into the NBA. And we had got a lot of interest to go back into the NBA from different teams. Well, once I went back and I made the All-Star team in the CBA, but right after the All-Star game, I got a call from the Canary Islands. to come and play. And my agent said, so what do you want to do? I jumped at the chance to go to the Canary Islands to play, because you guys know I'm a beach guy. I love the beach. And so I went over to the Canary Islands, and that was it. I didn't want to go back trying for the NBA anymore, because my dream had already been fulfilled. It was a business after that.
You know, the Canary Islands are like one of the best tourist attraction places in Europe. And it's kind of expensive to go there. It's not cheap. Everyone says go to Tenerife, go to Mallorca. Places like that are heaven in Europe and Mediterranean. We have a technical issue. Εμείς ήμασταν εδώ, Νικόλα. Δεν ξέρω, είμαστε live αυτή τη στιγμή. Okay, κανένα πρόβλημα αυτό. Συγγνώμη για το τεχνικό πρόβλημα. Εντάξει, αυτά είναι ανθρώπινα, συμβαίνουν σε μια live μετάδοση. Ουσιαστικά μας είπε ότι στα Κανάρια νησιά είχε το career high του με 50 πόντους. Ήταν μια υπέροχη εμπειρία. Ήταν, όπως μας είπε και στην αρχή, είναι ένας άνθρωπος που, όπως είναι, όπως κάθε άνθρωπος που μένει στη Φλόριντα, πεθαίνει για παραλίες, για τη θάλασσα. Οπότε ήταν μια εμπειρία που του άρεσε πάρα πολύ. Αντρέα μου, συνέχισε.
Before my next question, I want to read some messages from our viewers. And first of all, from your former teammate Agrati, Nico Stolias. Do you remember Nico?
Yes, I do remember Nico.
Hello, Richard, my man. We played together at Agrati. Glad to see you're fine.
Well, you make sure you tell all of my friends I say hello. I miss those guys.
The most of the messages are very thankful to you for our presence here in Greece. And Mr. John Nikos Petrou asks greetings to one of the most charismatic players that we have seen in our league from the end. Ask him if he would recommend our country in the future to his son for a pro career. And does he recommend that coaches should guide the new players to get more defensive, athletic and tough, or more agile with better offensive skills?
I think they should be more athletic and play more defense, because everybody can score. And I remember your other question was about my son coming over to Greece to play. Trust me, if he has an opportunity to come to Greece to play, I'm sending him to Greece to play. Because I love Greece. I want to take my son and my family to Greece to play.
By the way, sorry. By the way, I think you told us before the show that he just finished high school, right?
No. He's a senior this year in high school.
Senior means his last year, right?
Yes, his last year. Yes.
So, how did he experience the coronavirus? So everything stopped. The college ball stopped. Listen, and
yes,
what
this
will
is what
happen
with the kids? This is what happened with the kids. The kids can only go now. He's at what they call hybrid. He can only go to school 2 days a week. He goes 2 days a week, and everything else he does on the computer, online. And as far as college goes, because he's getting recruited, he's getting college letters. He's gotten one from University of Tampa. He's gotten a letter from Penn State. And what they do is they have to do everything online because of the coronavirus. They can't come see the kids now. You can only do videos from games. Now, his high school can play games. But they just can't, college coaches won't come because of the coronavirus. So I communicate with them online, and my son is excited for this year to start, for his season to start, and I'm looking forward as well.
Will his year continue regularly, even though online, and then the next year he will go to college?
Yes, that's pretty much what happens. It'll continue this way online, because me personally, I don't think the kids are going back to school 5 days a week. They'll go a couple of days, because no one wants to take that risk and put these kids in danger. And so I think the way it is right now, they'll do it. Just to be honest, my son loves being home doing his work and school 2 days a week, because he still goes to basketball practice.
Ουσιαστικά κάναμε μία μικρή παρένθεση. Είπαμε ότι λόγω του κορονοϊού ο γιος του, ο οποίος παίζει αυτή τη στιγμή στο high school τελευταία του χρονιά και την επόμενη χρονιά θα πάει στο κολέγιο, αυτή τη στιγμή κάνει δύο φορές τη βδομάδα μαθήματα online. Τις άλλες πέντε μπορεί να πάει να προπονηθεί, να παίξει μπάσκετ. Κανονικά θα γίνει αυτή η χρονιά και απλά την επόμενη θα πάει στο κολέγιο, ήδη έχει κάποια γράμματα, κάποια recruiting, όπως από το Πανεπιστήμιο του Τάμπα. Από εκεί και πέρα, σίγουρα, εάν βρεθεί ευκαιρία, αν του έρθει ευκαιρία να παίξει στην Ελλάδα, θα το κάνει χωρίς συζήτηση. Αντρίκο μου, συγγνώμη και συνέχισε.
Καλό, παρακαλώ. Richard, Daphne, debuting for Daphne against Olympiakos of Zarco, Zarco 54, U 30, and Daphne, a small team, wins Olympiakos.
Well, my greatest experience in all of Europe was beating Olympiakos. And the people of Daphne was amazing. And I think it changed the scope for small teams in Greece when we beat Olympiakos. Because then it gave everybody, even though Olympiakos was great, it gave every other small team like Daphne a chance, because if we could beat them, other teams felt the same way. And listen, the greatest career I had, one of the greatest times I had, was that was my biggest game, was Olympiakos and Daphne.
You know that you were the first American to win the scoring champion prize here in Greece.
Yes. The way I found out was from a bunch of reporters. And like I told you earlier, it's nice to hear from you guys, but it was even better to hear from the greatest scorer in all of Greece, Nick Galax. Nick called me when I became the first scorer. And when I tell you, I felt like I really made it when Nick called me. I was nice to hear from everybody else, but when Nick Galax called me, that was it for me. That did it.
We asked you before on the offer, but I would like to repeat it. Do you think that Nick Galax could play in the NBA?
I think Nick Galax could have played in the NBA easy and probably would have won the Sixth Man of the Year award easy. Mm-hmm. You know, he was more to me, I tell my friends that talk about great players, he was more like Vinnie Johnson. And if anybody knows, and everybody here in America knows Vinnie Johnson, he was the ultimate scorer. He could come in and change the whole game. And to me, that was Nick Galax, one of the greatest European players I had ever seen. Mm-hmm.
Ρωτήσαμε τον Ρίτσαρντ για την εμπειρία του στη Δάφνη, όπου στον ντεμπούτο του με την ομάδα της Δάφνης σκόραρε 30 πόντους. Η Δάφνη κέρδισε τον Ολυμπιακό του Ζάρκο, ο οποίος είχε βάλει 54 σε εκείνο το παιχνίδι. Ο Ρίτσαρντ μας είπε ότι ήταν η καλύτερη εμπειρία του στην Ευρώπη και στην Δάφνη αυτό το παιχνίδι. Το θεωρεί το καλύτερο παιχνίδι της καριέρας του. Επίσης, ο Ρίτσαρντ ήταν ο πρώτος Αμερικανός που κέρδισε το βραβείο του πρώτου σκόρερ. Και μας είπε ότι ήταν μεγάλη του τιμή όταν τον κάλεσε τηλεφωνικός ο Νίκος Γκάλης για να το συγχαρεί για αυτό το επίτευγμα. Ρωτήσαμε αν θεωρεί ότι ο Νίκος Γκάλης μπορούσε να παίξει στο NBA και η απάντηση ήταν σαφέστατα. Ο Νίκος ήταν ένας τρομερός παίκτης. Θα ήταν υποψήφιος σχεδόν κάθε χρόνο για το βραβείο του έκτου παίκτη, θεωρεί ο Ρίτσαρντ. Και μας τον παραλύλησε με τον Βίνι Τζόνσον, ο οποίος ήταν ένας τρομερός game changer. Και θεωρεί ότι αν ο Νίκος κατάφερε να πάει, αν ήθελε να πάει στο NBA, θα είχε αυτό το ρόλο που είχε ο Βίνι Τζόνσον στους Detroit Pistons. Γιώργο μου.
Ναι. Did you know about Nick Galax when you first arrived? Well, that would be in AEK. But how is watching him in action? How is it going up against him?
Well, for me, I've always thought Nick was one of the great players. I heard about Nick Galax when I was in Israel, before I came over to Greece. And when I got to Greece, I was looking forward to playing against Nick because I always wanted to play against the best players in the country. And for me, Nick was the greatest player in that country, in Greece. And playing against Nick, it's tough because I didn't have to guard him. I felt sorry for the guys that had to play defense on Nick because no matter if you were American or you're a European player, Nick was going to do the same thing to you. He was going to give you 30, 35 points, and you were going to look around and say, this little guy, this is the little guy everybody's talking about? Yeah, now you know what that little guy is about. So Nick, for me, man, Nick was a great player. And for me, he will always go down as one of the greatest European players I've ever played against and ever seen.
You know, if he took the right lane and he drove right, it was over. There is nothing you could only hope that he would miss. Nothing less than that.
You're wrong.
Richard,
if you like, I want you to tell me the best player in Israel, in Spain, and in Greece.
Well, the best player, when I got to Israel, the best American player was, not, I felt was me, but they had a guy by the name of McGee.
McGee, yes.
Yeah, they had McGee there. But the best Israeli player was Jumpsy. Jumpsy was the best one. Now in Spain, when I got to Spain, wow, they had so many great players. They had some Spanish kid named Martinez. Martinez was, I thought he was one of the greatest Spanish players. Italy, the only guy I knew in Italy was Magnifico. Do you guys know who Magnifico is?
Yes, yes.
Well, that was the greatest Italian player I had seen. And the bad thing was he played with Bob McAdoo. That's how their team was. You know,
He went to Atlanta in 1986. He went to a training camp in Hall to play with Hawks. He and Gasbinelli. He did some training with the Hawks, and I believe their assistant coach back then was Willis Reed, the Knick legend. And there is a picture of those two in the NBA, though they decided to come back. They wanted also to play for their national team, which back then was prohibited if you became pro. And that was the story. Αντρέα, μου θα μεταφράσεις.
Ναι. Ρωτήσαμε τον Ρίτσαρντ για τους καλύτερους παίκτες που αντιμετώπισε, που είδε μάλλον στο Ισραήλ, στην Ισπανία και στην Ελλάδα. Στο Ισραήλ μας είπε ότι ο καλύτερος Αμερικανός θεωρούσε τον εαυτό του. Αλλά πιστεύει ότι ο καλύτερος Αμερικανός αγωνιζόταν στο Ισραήλ ήταν ο Κέβιν Μαγκή. Όσο για Ισραηλινό μας είπε για τον Ντόρον Τζάμψη, τον μεγάλο σκόρερ της Μακάμπη. Στην Ισπανία μας μίλησε για τον Αντώνιο Μαρτίν. Και επίσης για τον Γιώργο, συγγνώμη, κόλλησα.
Ντόρον Τζάμψη είπαμε.
Και μας είπε για τον Βάλτερ Μανίφικο,
τον
καλό power forward της Καβολίνη, τον οποίο θεωρεί πολύ μεγάλο παίχτη.
Συνέχισε, Αντρέα μου.
After Daphne, you went back to Israel.
To Poland.
Yes, why Israel again? And not Italy, not Spain, not Greece. You didn't have any proposals?
Yes, we did have proposals to other countries, but the Israeli guy who was the owner of Holon paid me $300,000.
Okay.
So I left. So the money made me leave. Trust me on that one.
Okay. Ο Ρίτσαρντ μετά την Δάφνη πήγε πάλι στο Ισραήλ και από Ελχολόν. Το ρίξαμε αν δεν είχε, γιατί ξανά Ισραήλ και όχι κάποια άλλη ευρωπαϊκή ομάδα, ευρωπαϊκή χώρα και ομάδα, όπως η Ιταλία, η Ελλάδα, η Ισπανία. Και η απάντηση ήταν απλή και ρεαλιστική. Του έδωσαν 300.000 δολάρια για ένα χρόνο. Οπότε ήταν λογικό να πάει στο Ισραήλ. And then Παγκράτη. I have only one question for Παγκράτη.
Sure.
Σάκη Τζαλαλής.
Sakis, I know you're going to ask me about Sakis. First of all, I love to play with him. We didn't like playing against Sakis because, you know, Sakis was very physical. That's what Saki did. Well, I love playing on my team because every American we sent Sakis to, and he took care of it. So believe me, I enjoyed. How is it, when you see him? If you see him, you make sure you tell him hi and thank you.
Okay. Okay. Γιώργο, θα να τα φράσεις. Γιατί εγώ γελάω ακόμα.
Ένας από τους αγαπημένους του συμπαίκτες, ο Σάκης ήταν, ήταν πολύ physical και όλοι και, ήταν η αλήθεια είναι ότι χαιρότανε που τον έχει στην ομάδα του και όχι αντίπαλο, γιατί ο Σάκης δεν έδειχνε ικτό ούτε Αμερικανός ούτε Έλληνας, απλά όποιος περνούσε θα περνούσε δύσκολα.
Αντρέα, say it this way. Sakis was our Dennis Rodman.
But more physical, because Dennis wasn't that much of a physical guy. He, no, he played wasn't. With your mind.
Αν μας βλέπει ο Σάκης Ζαλής, θέλουμε να ξέρει...
Εντάξει, νομίζω ότι άκουσες το καλύτερο κομπλιμέντο όλων των εποχών.
Αποκάλεσε ο Dennis Rodman του Παγκρατίου.
Σάκαρε, άμα τα ακούς, νομίζω ότι...
Αγαπάμε Σάκη Ζαλής.
Σ' αγαπάμε, απλά. Αντρέα μου, συνέχισε.
We love Σάκη Ζαλής.
That was my guy, man.
You had a great season with Pagrati, but Pagrati relegated. Why?
Well, I think because, you know, behind the scenes, you know, the Greek league is a very tough league. And you can't just have only good Americans. You got to have good Greek players as well. Because from the top team in Greece to the last team in Greece, they all were very, very tough. I wish that they could have stayed up to first division because it was another place that I could have played forever. Because any team in Greece, I could have played forever, man. That's how much I loved it over there.
Ρωτήσαμε τον Ρίτσαρντ ότι παρόλο που έδειξε μια πολύ καλή χρονιά με το Παγκράτη που βιβάστηκε, δεν κατάφερε να κρατήσει την κατηγορία. Τον ρωτήσαμε τον λόγο και μας είπε ότι το ελληνικό πρωτάθλημα εκείνη την εποχή ήταν πάρα πολύ δύσκολο. Πάρα πολύ. Με πολύ καλές ομάδες. Και εκτός από καλούς Αμερικανούς, η ομάδα χρειαζόταν και να έχει και άλλους, γενικά και άλλους καλούς παίχτες. Αλλά ο ίδιος, αν τον ρωτάγαμε, θα ήθελε να παίξει σε οποιαδήποτε ελληνική ομάδα. Και την περίοδο που αγωνίστηκε στην Ελλάδα ήταν η καλύτερη του. After Pagrati, you didn't live from Greece. You went south, to Crete, Antiraklio. Your experience there.
One of the most beautiful places I have ever been in my entire life, Heraklion. Because you know, at that time, the owner of the team owned a resort in Heraklion, in Crete. And when I came over to Crete 3 weeks to a month before the season started because me and Jose could not believe that we got to train and then stay on in a resort for the summer. And it was beautiful. I could not believe. We wish that we could have stayed in the first division and played there forever as well. I told you, Greece was a great place to be. It really was.
Ο Ρίτσαρντ, μετά την Μεδόλου Παγκράτη, πήγε νότια στην Κρήτη, για την ομάδα του Ηρακλείου, όπου εκείνη την εποχή ο ιδιοκτήτης ήταν ο Μανώλης Παπακαλιάτης, που είχε στην κατοχή του ξενοδοχειακές εγκαταστάσεις. Ο Ρίτσαρντ μας είπε ότι αυτός και ο Πικουλίνο Ρτίφ, που ήταν τότε το δίδυμο των ξένων, δεν πίστευαν ότι κάνουν προετοιμασία σε τέτοιες εγκαταστάσεις και πήγαν τρεις εβδομάδες πριν ξεκινήσει η χρονιά για να μείνουν στο ξενοδοχείο του κ. Παπακαλιάτη. Του άρεσε πάρα πολύ η Κρήτη, του άρεσε πάρα πολύ η Ελλάδα, όπως είχε καταλάβει από τα λεγόμενα του, λατρεύει την Ελλάδα. Και αυτός και ο Πικουλίν έλεγαν ότι θα μπορούσαν να μείνουν για πάντα στην Ελλάδα και να παίξουν για πάντα στο ελληνικό πρωτάθλημα. Γιώργο μου, θα συνεχίσεις.
I think that, Andreas, we should stay in Greece a bit more, since I believe that is what interests our fans more. I would like to ask you about Fanis. Fanis Christodoulou, a great defender, one of the best Greek players of all time. You had the honor and the pleasure of going up against him, and I think it was your matchup, unlike Nikos Galis. Would you like to tell us a bit more about him?
I thought that Fanis was probably the toughest guy that I had to play against. because not only was he my size or a little bigger, he had every tool to be a great basketball player. I thought that he could have played in the NBA easy if that is what he had chose to do. I understand that people said that Finis didn't work hard, but I always wished if he had worked hard, Finis would have been one of the great NBA players of our time as well.
You know, we hosted about a week or two ago another great player from the United States, Derek Hamilton. And he said about Finis that he may have looked slow, but he was fast. He had great feet, and he was all about positioning. He knew how to go to your side, despite his supposed athletic disadvantage.
I listened to everybody over there say how he was overweight, he wasn't in shape. I listened to that, but those people had never played against him. Because just like Derek said, he may have looked slow, but believe me, he got to that basket and you would turn around and say, wow, what did he do? And you know, he didn't really jump that high. And he could do things that we were always amazed. And I said to him one day, why don't you want to go to the NBA? And he just didn't want to go. He listen, you see how much I love Greece. Well, imagine how the Greek boys feel. They love Greece as well, just as much as I do.
Αντρίκο μου, θα μου βοηθήσει άμα σε χρειαστώ. Νομίζω βέβαια τα θυμάμαι.
Mm-hmm.
Ο Φάνης είναι ένας από τους κορυφαίους, νομίζω το έχουμε πει πολλά και σε αυτή την εκπομπή και θα τα ξαναπούμε, ένας από τους κορυφαίους παίκτες που έχουν παίξει ποτέ. Σίγουρα έχουμε πολλές φορές έχει αναφερθεί ότι ίσως δεν δούλεψε αρκετά, ίσως ότι αν δούλευε πολύ περισσότερο, όπως λέει και ο Ρίτς, θα έπαιζε στο NBA. Κάποια στιγμή μάλιστα τον ρώτησε σε έναν αγώνα, γιατί δεν πας στο NBA? Και δεν ήθελε, πολύ απλά. Δηλαδή, του άρεσε η Ελλάδα. Λέει, εδώ άρεσε στο Ρίτς που είναι Αμερικανός, έτσι. Πόσο μάλλον σε έναν Έλληνα. Δηλαδή, δεν ήθελε να φύγει ο Φάνης. Και πολλές φορές λένε κάποιοι ίσως ότι ήταν αργό, μπορεί να φαινόταν αργός, ο, να ήταν παχύσαρκος. Αλλά δεν είχαν παίξει ένα παιχνίδι απέναντι στο Φάνη. Δεν μπορούσαν να καταλάβουν το πόσο γρήγορος ήταν και το πόσο έξυπνα έβαζε το σώμα του. Αντρέα μου, θες να συνεχίσεις και να ρωτήσεις για κάποιον άλλον παίκτη?
Richard, only to the part of the defending skills. Φάνης Ιστοδούλου or Γιώργος Σιγάλας?
You say which player?
Who was the most difficult from you to offend?
Well, I didn't have to guard Nick Gallus. No, and just to let you know,
talking about Giorgos Sigalas of Olympiacos. Do you remember Giorgos Sigalas?
Yeah, I remember Sigalas. Yes, yes. You say who? Because he's a defensive guy.
Yes. Yeah.
Nick, I still say Fasulas. I mean, Finis. Finis was the toughest. Yeah, but I remember Nico. I remember him.
From the seven shooters, Fasulas, Vrankovic, who was the toughest?
For scores? Talich was one of the tough scorers for us. I like Fasulas because you guys got to remember now, I know Fasulas from when he went to Michigan State in Lansing, Michigan. Mm-hmm. And we were good friends over there in Greece. So I thought he was if he had gained weight, he could have played in the NBA as well. Mm-hmm. He just didn't want to because, listen, I saw his yacht, his boat when I was there. There was no reason for him to come to the NBA, trust me. He was living pretty good in Greece.
You know, Shaquille O'Neal also said that. Back in 1994, do I remember correctly, Andreas?
Yeah,
1994, yes. Shaq said, oh, you know, I like your big man, Fasulas, back then a lot, but he needs to gain some weight in order to face me. By the way, Andrew asked, who was the toughest defender for you as an opponent? Was it Stoiko Vrankovic, or Fasulas? Who would you dare drive the ball against? Would you drive against Fasulas or against Stoiko Vrankovic?
Stoiko.
Because both of them were...
I'm a drive against Stoiko because sometime when I drove against Fasulas, I couldn't even see the basket once he jumped because he was so tall. I couldn't even see the basket. So, Stoiko, yeah, was probably easier for me to drive against.
You know that's a first. You know. What did you say, Andreas?
I'm saying that he's the first player that says that Stoico was easier to drive.
You know, that was a first. And no, it surprised. Both of them were amazing defenders, were probably two of the greatest rim protectors that Europe has ever seen. And sometimes we discuss it amongst ourselves that the Europe hadn't seen such great rim protectors until right now, Rudy Gobert. Mm-hmm. Before Rudy Gobert, two of the greatest was Stoico. We had him as number one, and Panayoti Fasula as number two. But it was the first that the guy said that, you know, Fasula's was tougher, and that's why we were a bit surprised. In a good sense, not in a bad sense, of course.
Well, let me explain to you why. Why Fasulis was tougher. Because Fasulis was quicker. Because he wasn't as big as Junko. He was not as big. So he was kind of slow. So it was easy for me to drive by him. With Fasulis, if you drive by him, you don't know he's because he's quick enough to catch up from behind. That's why. Fasulis blocked a couple of my shots from behind me. Stoic couldn't because I could see him. That's why he was tougher.
You got many great points right here. Η διαφορά του Στοϊκού με τον Παναγιώτη Φασούλα είναι ότι ο Φασούλας είχε γρήγορα πόδια, είχε πιο γρήγορα πόδια. Ο Φασούλας μπορούσε να σε ακολουθήσει, μπορούσε να σου ρίξει τάπα από πίσω, μπορούσε να σου πάρει τα βήματα. Αντίθετα, ο Στοϊκού ήταν απλά ψηλότερος. Ψηλότερος ήταν, σήκωνε τα χέρια, σίγουρα και οι δύο είναι δύο από τους κορυφαίους rim protectors που έχει δει ποτέ η Ευρώπη. Νομίζω σε αυτό συμφωνούμε, Αντρέα.
Ναι, βέβαια.
Εννοείται αυτό. Αλλά θεωρεί ότι η ταχύτητα του Φασούλα, αν και ήταν λίγο μικρότερος στη σωματοδομή, τον ευνοούσε περισσότερο γιατί μπορούσε να ακολουθήσει το drive. Σε αντίθεση με το Στόικο που μπορούσε να περάσει πιο γρήγορα από δίπλα του. Αντρίκο μου, συνέχισε.
Richard, since we are talking about big men and seven footers, during your career in Spain, you faced Arvydas Sabonis. Was Sabonis tough?
Well, you didn't ask me who was the toughest big man in all of Europe. It was Sabonis. So trust me, Sabonis was probably the toughest big guy I ever played against. Because Sabonis, when I told you guys that Sabonis he could block the basket, well, just imagine. I just thought that Sabonis was so big. And he could move. He could really move. And so he was probably the toughest center I ever played against. And I think, till this day, Sabonis was the greatest passer of any big man you've ever seen. No big man ever passed the ball better than Sabonis.
I totally agree. Ρωτήσαμε τον Ρίσαρντ για την, εφόσον πιάσαμε τους ψηλούς, για τη θητεία του στην Ισπανία, όπου αντιμετώπισε τον Άρβιντα Σαμπόνις. Και μας είπε χαρακτηριστικά ότι δεν είχαμε ρωτήσει για το ποιος ήταν ο δυσκολότερος ψηλός αντίπαλος που αντιμετώπισε στην Ευρώπη. Και μας είπε για τον Σαμπόνις, ο οποίος ήταν πραγματικά τεράστιος, θυμόμαστε όλοι τη σωματοδομή του Άρβιντας. Αλλά ενώ είχε αυτό το κορμί, μπορούσε να κινηθεί πολύ γρήγορα. Και επίσης ήταν ο κορυφαίος πασέρ ψηλός που είδε ποτέ. Αυτό ισχύει για τον Άρβιντας. Γιώργο, ξέρω δεν συμφωνείς για το Γιώργο, αλλά εγώ επιμένω για τον Άρβιντα.
No. I wanted to ask about Bill Walton, the only guy that I believe that could pass as Arvidas was Bill Walton, no one else. But, you know, I was thinking that many people in the United States didn't know Arvidas until he went to the Blazers some years later. And I'm thinking that you had the pleasure, though still he had injuries, but you saw Arvidas with more stamina, he could move a bit more well. And I think that, in a sense, you were blessed. You were lucky to see Arvidas in greater shape than when he went there. And, you know, before the 90s, he was even better. He was even stronger. He could jump high. But anyway, you saw him in great shape. And I was thinking that most of them don't know. And they say that if Sabonis went healthy to the NBA, that he would dominate the league.
He would be a Hall of Famer if he had came here when he was younger. He'll be in the NBA Hall of Fame because that's how great he was. I tell people to this day, we see his son play now.
Who plays with the Pacers.
His son. I tell my son, who watches his son, because that my son doesn't know Sabonis. He knows the young Sabonis, the player. I told my son, his dad was three times better than he was. That's how great his dad was. His dad, his son could not hold a candle to his father. And his son is a great player.
Yeah, that's true. And when he watched highlights of him, was he in shock, saying, what the hell did I just see?
My son says to me, he didn't know that big guys that big could pass so great. And I told my son, the reason I think that Sabonis could pass so good, because he could see over everyone. Because he was the tallest. And he could see better. And because of that, he would make passes that you would not believe. You've never seen a 7-foot guy throw the ball behind his back for a backdoor layup. That was Sabonis.
And he had soft hands, really soft touch for a big man. And you know, there was also Vlade Divac, another great passing player.
Yes.
But Arvidas's passing skills was a level higher. You know, he gave some passes.
In Europe? Are you familiar with his nickname in Europe?
What is his nickname in Europe?
The Miracle of Nature.
Really? The Miracle of Nature? Really? Listen, what is he doing now?
He's the president of Lithuania, of the Lithuanian Federation.
Yes, the Basketball Federation in Lithuania. He's president.
Okay, because I'm going to tell you, if anybody's around him, they should try to get some of that knowledge and some of those skills that he had. Because he would be a great teacher.
Αντρίκο μου, θα συνεχίσεις. Να μεταφράσουμε πρώτα.
Να μεταφράσεις και θα συνεχίσω.
Ουσιαστικά μιλήσαμε λίγο για τον Αρβίντα Σαμπόνις. Είχε την τιμή και τη χαρά να παίξει μαζί του όταν ήταν στην Ισπανία. Ένας παίκτης που έχει αφήσει το δικό του στίγμα και μας ρώτησε και όλα τι κάνει και του είπαμε ότι είναι πρόεδρος της Λιθουανικής Ομοσπονδίας και λέει ότι όποιος είναι δίπλα του θα πρέπει να μάθει από αυτό. Ο γιος του δεν τον ήξερε και μάλιστα είπε ότι παρακολουθούσε highlight και έλεγε ότι ο γιος του, ο Ντομάντας, είναι εξαιρετικός παίκτης, πολύ καλός παίκτης. Αλλά ο Αρβίντας απλά ήταν τρία επίπεδα πιο πάνω. Ήταν ένας από τους κορυφαίους παίκτες στην Ευρώπη. Μπορούσε να τρέξει παρά το ύψος. Ήταν τεράστιος σαν ύψος και σαν σωματοδομή. Αλλά μπορούσε να κουνηθεί, μπορούσε να τρέξει. Και όχι μόνο αυτό. Είχε soft hands. Ήταν από τους καλύτερους, ίσως ο κορυφαίος passing center, ο κορυφαίος πασέρ ψηλός όλων των εποχών. Και όχι, Αντρέα, δεν διαφωνώ με αυτό. Δεν είναι ο Jokic. It's not Nikola Jokic. Jokic is a great player, but he wasn't as physically gifted as Sabonis. Sometimes I often joke to Andreas that Nikola Jokic maybe knows the same basketball, has the same basketball skills as Arvidas, but Arvidas was 10 points taller, 10 points wider, and he could jump in his prime. He had a 10 inches greater vertical. So it's not the same. Nikola Jokic is a great basketball player. His IQ is off the charts. But imagine that plus the body of Arvidas. Because Jokic was a bit fat, let's be honest.
Yeah.
Arvidas was a freak of nature. Και επίσης εξηγήσαμε ότι γι' αυτό το λόγο ότι ο Arvidas ήταν ένα τέρας της φύσης, ότι όσο καλός και να είναι ο Nikola Jokic, να φανταστούμε ότι εγώ, αυτό είναι δικιά μου άποψη, ξεκάθαρα και το λέω, ότι ο Jokic ίσως ξέρει το ίδιο μπάσκετ με τον Arvidas, αλλά ο Arvidas ήταν 10 πόντους ψηλότερους, ήταν 10 πόντους πιο μακρύς, και απλά μπορούσε να επιδείξει 10 πόντους ψηλότερα. Οπότε και πάλι δεν υπάρχει σύγκριση. The last years of your career you spent in Cyprus. Again to the sea, next to the sea, in Cyprus. And a bit in Argentina, I believe. How was your experience back there? Cyprus was a lesser league in Europe.
Yes.
But it's a great place.
It was a retirement gig. I went because I wanted to see all of Europe, all of Greece. I went to Argentina and Turkey after those countries. Turkey and Argentina was nothing like Greece. I enjoyed it. That was towards the end of my career when I knew I wasn't going to play much longer, but I wanted to see the world. And playing basketball, that's what it did for me, fellas. I got to see the world. I enjoyed those other countries, but the countries that I really love were the countries I lived in the longest, which was Greece and Israel. I enjoyed those countries. And I will be forever thankful that I got a chance to play there. I have to get my son to practice, fellas. It's basketball practice now. So I have to take my son to basketball practice.
Right now?
Yeah, at 3:30. I have to leave to go to prep basketball practice. How much time do you need?
No. You know, we will do the last questions and we will end the show. That is not a problem. You already told us so many and great things that we are thankful for that. Anyway, let me translate, move on to the last questions, and then we will finish the show. Ουσιαστικά η Αργεντινή και η Κύπρος ήταν μέρη συνταξιοδότησης, είπε εισαγωγικά. Ήξερε ότι η καριέρα τελειώνει και ήθελε να γνωρίσει όσο το περισσότερο δυνατό από την Ευρώπη. Σίγουρα τα δύο αγαπημένα του μέρη ήταν τα μέρη που έζησε περισσότερο, η Ελλάδα και το Ισραήλ. Αντρέα μου, θες να κάνεις τις τελευταίες ερωτήσεις να κάνω και εγώ και να κλείσουμε?
Richard, your all-time favorite, your all-time five favorite in NBA and Europe?
My all-time favorite in NBA is Magic Johnson, Michael Jordan, LeBron James, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, and Shaquille O'Neal. Well, I got one more because I love Kobe Bryant as well. Kobe Bryant was one of my favorites. And in Europe, it was Nick Gallis, Magnifico, Mickey Bekovic. The two other ones was the big kid that played for Panathinaikos. What was his? We just talked about. What was his name?
Stoiko Vrankovic.
I love Stoiko. I love Stoik. And Spanis. Spanis are my favorite players.
Okay. The all-time pedala to Richard to NBA in Magic Johnson, Mike Jordan, LeBron James, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, Shaquille O'Neal. Πλάς τον Kobe Bryant, τον οποίο λατρεύει. Και στην Ευρώπη, ο Νίκος Γκιάλης, ο Μίκη Μπέρκοβιτς, ο Βάλτερ Μανίφικο, ο Φάνης και ο Στόγιαν Βράνκοβιτς.
Αντρέα μου, έχεις κάτι άλλο να ρωτήσεις?
Από μου μπορείς να κλείσεις, να πάει και ο Ρίσαρτ στη δουλειά του άνθρωπος.
My final two questions, they will be a bit short. The first one is, have you regretted anything in your career? Are you a guy that has regrets, or are you a guy that thinks keep moving on?
I am totally blessed. I lived out my dream. Basketball, I played for 15 years as a pro. I regret nothing from my sports and basketball. I am very grateful and thankful to God that I got to do what I did.
Δεν μετανιώνει για τίποτα, νιώθει ευλογημένος από το Θεό για την καριέρα, για την μπασκετική καριέρα την οποία είχε, και δεν μετανιώνει για τίποτα. And my second question is, you've been all around Europe, Greece, Spain, Israel, Cyprus. You traveled abroad since a young age. You saw different cultures. You saw different ways of thinking. What was a lesson you got from all that? What were your experience of traveling, of knowing the world, a world different than the United States?
I'm going to tell you, this is a perfect question. But I'm going to tell you what I love most about Europe. There was no racism in any country that I ever played in. They didn't care if you were black, white, green, or gold. That's what I love about Europe. Even to this day, all my friends, I still talk to a lot of them. We didn't have to worry about Black Lives Matter because in Europe, every life mattered. And so they didn't care about what color you were and how much money you had. That's what I love about Europe.
Είπε στην Ευρώπη ότι δεν υπάρχει. Αυτό που αγαπάει από την Ευρώπη είναι ότι δεν υπάρχει ρατσισμός. Στην Ευρώπη δεν μπορεί να, δεν υπάρχει Black Lives Matter, γιατί όλες οι ζωές μετράνε το ίδιο. Δεν μας ότι στην Ευρώπη δεν μας ενδιαφέρει αν κάποιος είναι μαύρος, άσπρος, χρυσός ή πράσινος. Το μόνο μας ενδιαφέρει είναι ότι είναι άνθρωπος και ούτε μας ενδιαφέρει πόσα λεφτά μπορεί να βγάζει κάποιος. Rich, I would like to thank you a lot for this small conversation we had. It was a pleasure, it was an honor. We had a great time. See, we're smiling, by the way, we can't hide it. And it was great. You know, in Greece, we love you. And we are thankful that we got to know you a bit as a person, as a way, as the way you're thinking. And we really thanks a lot. Andreas, would you like to tell him also, just before I can close the show?
I want also to thank you, Rich. It was a great honor. We love you here in Greece. We certainly love you. And we know that you love us. We miss you. We miss all the stories, all those years, this great championship, these great players like you, like yourself. And I want to thank you for these years, for those years.
Well, I want to thank all of you because what you guys, when I accept all you guys on Facebook, I want you to know the reason I do it. Because I know when I get the chance like this to talk to you, it brings back every memory I've ever had in Greece. And I must say, I only had good memories there. And that's why I love that place so much. That's why I keep saying, I'm coming back and I'm going to bring my family. Because I told my son, everybody over there love the basketball players. They love athletes. And they treat you all the same. The richest to the poorest, they treat the same. So thank you guys. I appreciate you.
Thank you.
Λοιπόν, thanks a lot, Rich. Αυτή ήταν ακόμα μια εκπομπή. Μας έφυγε, αλλά δεν πειράζει. Αυτά συμβαίνουν. Ήταν ακόμα μια εκπομπή Retro Stories από το The Basket Book. Περάσαμε υπέροχα για ακόμα μια φορά. Αύριο την Τετάρτη σε 9.30 ώρα είναι το Restart Youth με τον Αργύρη Παγαρτάνη και τον Χρήστο Παπαδούλη, ενώ στην Πέμπτη σε 9.30 ώρα, ενώ την Πέμπτη την ίδια ώρα είναι το Restart Basketball, όπου ο Χρήστος Μαριέλης θα φιλοξενήσει τον κορυφαίο σκόρερ στην ιστορία της Β' Εθνικής, τον Βασίλη Εμμανουηλίδη. Από όλους εμάς, ένα μεγάλο ευχαριστώ που ήσασταν μαζί μας και αύριο ελπίζουμε να είστε ξανά μαζί μας. Ανδρέα μου, σε ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ. Ελπίζω να πήγαν όλα καλά.
Ευχαριστούμε και πολύ τον Νικόλα για την άψογη τεχνική υποστήριξη.
Νικόλα, σε ευχαριστούμε πολύ. Καλό σας βράδυ.
Βράδυ.